16. There's some things in this life that we really like, isn't it? The things that you really like in this life, that's what you spend your time doing. That's what you spend your money doing. The things that you like in life. The things that you savor in life. Here in this passage, Jesus is asking a question about who do people say that he is. Look at verse 13. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. It says, when Jesus came to the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now, the answer that he gave is the correct answer. He says, you're the Christ. You're the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God. But he may say that, but who does the world say that he is? When Jesus did miracles, Herod thought that he might have been John the Baptist. Other people thought he might have been John the Baptist or Elias or one of the prophets. But after, as they look at this, he says, whom do ye say that I am? People said the different things, but he asked them, who do you say that I am? Who am I to you? Every person in this room, we need to come to the place to who do we believe Jesus Christ is. Now, I say that, but the truth of the matter is, how important is he to you? The title of the message is Savoring the Things of God. Just because we're a child of God, just because you're a Christian, doesn't mean you savor the things of God. There's some things in this life that you may invest in more than you invest in the things of God. Being a Christian doesn't mean you savor the things of God. So we need to come to the place that who do you say that he is? Is he the Son of God? Is he your Savior, the one who came and died and paid for your sins? Or is he someone that maybe you take lightly, meaning you don't take him that seriously? There's a lot of people in the world that say they believe he's God, they believe he's the Son of God, but they don't take him very seriously whatsoever. You may want him to take you to heaven or go to him in a great need, especially when there's a great need in life. People always turn to God. I talked to one gentleman, and he says, oh, I believe in God, but I believe in science too. And then he kind of smirked and smiled and put his head down. He says, but you know, every time I go through a crisis, I always turn and pray to him. I said, well, there's your answer right there. Who is he to you? When we come to a crisis, he is the one that can help you. Is he important enough for you to surrender your life to him? Is he someone you only need to meet once a week in church? There's a lot of people who do that. They don't take him seriously enough to be in his church. Or sometimes once a week's too much. Is he just an avenue to heaven? Is he a nuisance when it comes time for church? People get up, they'll go to church maybe once a week, and they'll think, oh, well, let's go do our duty. That's a nuisance. He's a nuisance to them. Notice verse 21. Matthew 16, verse 21. The Bible says, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to, notice that next word, to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Wait a minute. What did Peter just say before that? And he's telling Peter, you don't savor the things of God. You don't savor the things of God. You savor the things of men. Verse 24 says, then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, and let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then shall he reward every man according to his work. And every man's work will be according to what he savors the most. In verse 25, Jesus goes in a little different direction. He speaks of losing and finding as an illustration of the difference between things that people savor. For instance, if you love God, then he says you'll lose your life for my sake, meaning you will surrender it over to God. What he's talking about, losing your life for his sake, means, Lord, I can do this in the world, and I can make a lot of money. I can be rich. I can be famous. I can do these things in the world, but I'm going to lose that life for you and do whatever it is that you want me to do. I know preachers. My pastor could have been a radio disc jockey. He could have been famous in the area of sports and everything else. But he gave that part of his life up to be a preacher. And God's blessed him tremendously. Losing is finding. If you try to save your life, in other words, do the things that you want to do in this world, and many people do that, you lose your life for Christ's sake, meaning you'll not find the things that God wants to bless your life with. You'll not be enriched. You'll not receive those blessings that he has for you. Many men have been called of God to go into the ministry, and instead they were famous in sales. They were famous in other things. And what happened, they may have saved their life, but they lost it for Christ. If they would have followed the Lord in the area that he told them to do, they would have saved their children. I know too many people, they've not followed God, but they've lost their children to the world. My friend, my children are my greatest prize. They're the greatest blessings God's given to me, and I cannot afford not to follow God because I want God's blessing in my life. He says, whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. What are the things that you savor in this world? Let's pause for a moment and ask God to open our hearts and minds to his word. Father, in Jesus Christ's name, I beg for the filling of your Holy Spirit. I'm asking your Holy Spirit to speak through me. I'm asking you to reach down into every heart here today. Help us, Lord, to understand that we need to be dedicated to you. Either we believe you or we don't. Help us not to be... to take you lightly. Help us to take you very seriously and surrender our lives to you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. The cross of Jesus Christ was the central theme of the entire Bible, from the book of Genesis all the way through the book of Revelation. Everything points to the cross. As Jesus and his disciples are at the retreat at Caesarea Philippi, they're surrounded by a beautiful surroundings, by the beauty of nature. 25 miles to the north of the Sea of Galilee at the base of Mount Hermon flows a river with several beautiful waterfalls. Just above the waterfalls are caves and tunnels, trails, stone columns, shrines to false god of their time. And surrounded by the breathtaking beauty of the natural landscape, Jesus asked his disciples, whom say ye that I am? Am I one of these? Am I equal to one of these where people come and pay a little bit of tribute and go away? Here he is standing in the center of pagan worship near the grotto of Pan. Pan, who is a half man and half goat, who plays the flute. He's the god of the fields, the god of the wild and of nature. Jesus asked, who do you say that I am? Who am I to you? Am I as one of these? Or am I different? Am I special? Am I real in your life? Who is he? What do you think of me? Who am I compared to these statues and false god? Who is Jesus Christ when viewed through the eyes of the world? How important is Christ? How important is it going to church? Is it important to you to give money to God or to the world? What is the most important thing to you? What do you support the most, the things of God or the things of the world? And that's a question that we need to answer. Who is Jesus to you? Is he the central theme of your life? Where everything about your life is surrounded by Jesus Christ? Is he your life? Do you live to go to his house? Do you live to make his house full and beautiful? Do you live to tell others about Jesus Christ? Do you live to spread the gospel across the world? Do you live to raise your family God's way, to grow them up as arrows in the hands of a mighty man, sending them out into the world with direction to turn the world upside down for Christ? Who is he to you? When the question was asked, Peter spoke up in verse 16. He says, "Thou art the Christ." He's saying, you're the Messiah. You're the one that the prophets spoke of. Thou art the true God, the God of all gods, the Son of the living God. That's what he's saying. That's who you are. When Jesus spoke of the cross, it says that he began to teach them of the things that would lead him to the cross. When he spoke of the cross, he began to teach them how he must suffer. Notice verse 21. It says, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. But you're the Messiah. And you're going to go suffer and you're going to die. You're going to be killed. Everyone knew what the cross was. Everyone knew that that was the most cruel punishment that the Roman government instituted. It's the worst means of torture created by man. And the plan was to torture a man and make him put him in as much pain as they possibly could without killing him right away. They wanted him to suffer as long as possible, as long as they could before he actually died. And Jesus spoke of this death, how he must go to Jerusalem and how he must die on the cross. And the purpose that you and I know that Jesus went to the cross was he was going there to die for us. He was going there to pay the penalty of our sins so that we can be forgiven, so that our relationship with God can be restored and be with him forever in heaven. Jesus was going to the cross to pay for the sins of all mankind. But Peter did not understand Jesus' purpose. He rebuked Jesus. Notice verse 23. Verse 22. Matthew 16:22. Excuse me. Then Peter took him, and began to rebuke him. Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee. Peter rebuked the Lord Jesus Christ. It's one thing for a student to disagree with his teacher, but it's another thing entirely for a student to rebuke his teacher for the teaching. And Peter had the gall to confront the incarnate Word of God, the one who embodies all truth, and rebuke him for what he was teaching. The apostle who said, you're the Christ, you're the Son of the living God, is now rebuking the Christ, the Son of the living God, by saying, far be it from you. This shall never happen to you. Peter was saying that all the things that Jesus had predicted, his betrayal, his execution, would never happen to him. But then Jesus' response was equally as sharp. He rebuked Peter and he said, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Jesus was saying, Satan, you're an offense to me. He called him Satan. You are a breach in God's plan. You are in violation of not valuing the things that be of God. Violating? That was what offense means. Peter was acting like Satan is trying to violate God's plan of redemption. In order to redeem us from our sins, Jesus had to go to the cross and pay for our sins for us. He had to go to take our place. But then he calls him Satan. He says, get thee behind me, Satan. You say, why did he do that? If you remember in Matthew chapter 4, when Jesus went out into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil, Satan asked Jesus to bow down to him. You say, why would he do that? It was as if, I'm using my own imagination, as if he's suggesting, hey, nobody's going to see you. Nobody's going to know. If you do it, I'll give you the kingdoms of the world. You won't have to go through the cruel persecution of the cross. There will be no cup of wrath upon you. There will be no suffering at all. And Satan's temptation of Christ was trying to violate God's plan of redemption of man. Now we see the same violation again, whereby Satan was attacking Jesus through Peter. Jesus told Peter, your taste buds are wrong, Peter. Your desire is wrong. You have the wrong cravings. You want the wrong things. He says in verse 23, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. And you and I need to put a check on ourselves from time to time to see, do we want God's will? Do we want God's way? Do we want God to be the center of our life? What are the things that we really find to be the most important? What are the things that we savor in this life, that we desire, that we hunger for, that we crave for? What are those things that are important to us? Is it that they're important to me now, but they're not important to me later? Things of God always ought to be important to us. So what are the things of God that he says that you and I are to savor? I just want to give you about four or five of them. The first one, if you turn with me to James chapter 1, you and I ought to savor the Word of God. We ought to desire the Word of God. We ought to crave the Word of God. You say, why is that? Because the Word of God is able to save our souls. Here in James chapter 1, look down at verse 21. It says, wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. That engrafted word is the Word of God. All right? Then he says, but if be ye doers of the Word of God, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves, but if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway or immediately forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, that's the word of God, and continueth therein, he's practicing what he reads, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this man shall be blessed in his deed. He's talking about the person who is a real Christian. One of the reasons that I came to Christ is because I saw my pastor before he was my pastor. He's the one that led me to the Lord. I saw him as a real Christian. I saw him as a real man of God. He was teaching on prayer, and as he's teaching, I'm thinking, does he really believe what he's saying? And the more I studied him and observed him, I'm thinking, he believes what he's saying. He was real. But there's a lot of Christians that are fake. There's a lot of Christians that are in word only, but not in deed. They don't practice what a Christian's supposed to be like. And the world is looking for people to be real. They want you to be real. They respect you when you're real. That word engrafted, as it says here in verse 21, receive with meekness the engrafted word. That's a powerful word. That means the engrafted word, the word is able to engraft itself into your life to where the word and you become one. They become transplanted to be together. It becomes part of who you are. I am a Christian, and the word of God is what I live by. It's engrafted into my life. It's engrafted into my ways. It's engrafted into my doings, that the way I think, what I say, what I invest in, what I practice, I will go to church. I will do the things that are of God because I am a Christian. And a Christian will get into the Word of God. He will read it. He will desire it. He will crave it because that's who we are. This is my Father's Word. And I want to know what my Father says. So it teaches us in verse 21 that this Word of God is able to save our souls. It saves our souls by coming to Jesus Christ, placing your faith and Jesus Christ for salvation. And then because of that, we get into his word and we grow in his word. We learn from his word. The word of God is powerful. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. And then the next one will be Psalms chapter 119. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, we see that the word of God is living and the word of God is powerful. He says, for the word of God is quick. That word quick means it's alive. It's a living. It breathes. For the word of God is quick. It's living. It's powerful. and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow. And notice this. This is something that I cannot do as a person. This is something that I cannot do as a preacher. And it says here, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. I cannot read your mind. There's times as a kid I used to think my mother could read my mind. She knew what I was doing and why I was doing it. I always got caught. She would say, guilt is written all over your face, and I just do one of these. She had eyes in the back of her head. But I can't do that. But the Word of God, as we preach the Word of God, it speaks to you. It engrafts itself into your heart and into your life. And it does something this preacher cannot do. It says to you, guilty. Or it says to you, that's right. This is what you need to do. Oh, you don't need to do that. The Word of God guides you. It leads you. It's a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. That word quick means it's living. It's alive right now. People mock the Word of God as, oh, that's an old book that's thousands of years old. It's outdated. No, it's not. It's alive. And the Holy Spirit takes that word and uses it to speak to our hearts. I love Psalm 119. Look down at verse 97. We are to love the Word of God. Why is that? What does the Word of God do for us? In Psalms 119, verse 97, David says, oh, how love I thy law. I love it. I love your word. It is my meditation all the day. I think on it. All day long, I can't take my mind off your word because it's true. It's right. Verse 98, thou, through thy commandments, has made me wiser than mine enemies, for they are ever with me. Lord, through your word has made me smarter. Your word has made me wiser than mine enemies. 99, I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. Oh, I think of these kids in the public schools today and the things that they're teaching. Christian young people who go to the schools and they know their Bible. Well, I tell you what, some of those young people are smarter than their teachers. Some of them are wiser than their teachers because of what the Word of God does for them. I understand more than the ancients, verse 100, because I kept thy precepts. I have refrained my feet from every evil way that I might keep thy word. What is it saying there? The Word of God has kept me from going down the wrong paths. The Word of God has kept me from making bad decisions. The Word of God has turned my direction in the right way. That's why it's a discerner of the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Because you might be at a point of making a critical decision, an important decision. And as the Holy Spirit takes the Word of God, He puts it deep into your heart, and that Word of God may change your direction into the right direction. Verse 102, I have not departed from thy judgments, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts, thy principles, I get understanding. Therefore, because of this, I hate every false way. I hate every false way. When a person is in God's Word, reading God's Word, memorizing God's Word, studying God's Word, you're going to see less gray areas. You're going to see more color, black or white, right or wrong. And the gray areas in life get smaller and smaller. Smaller, the more you get into the Word of God. And He says, through thy precepts, I get understanding. Because of this, I hate every false way. We're living in a world that's chasing false ways all over the place. And God puts us on the right path. So we're to savor the Word of God. The Word of God saves us. The Word of God corrects us. The Word of God guides us. The Word of God is living, and it grafts itself into our hearts and our minds. So the second thing, we ought to savor the power of God on our lives. There's five reasons that I want to give you, and I need to run through these real quick, why Christians don't have God's power in their lives. The first one is obvious. It's sin. And I just got one verse for each of these, but there's many. In Psalm 66:18, the Bible says, if I regard if I hide iniquity or sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Many Christians are hiding sin in their lives, and therefore their prayers are not answered. We know that the Bible says, thou shalt not. You shouldn't do this. You shouldn't do that. But we love, we cherish those things. We savor the things that God says is wrong. We disobey the things that God tells us to do, and we're not going to change. Therefore, you're hiding iniquity in your heart. Therefore, the power of God is not on your life. Therefore, when you try to witness to people, your words just fall dead short because there's things in your life that you refuse to surrender over to God. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. So sin is one of the five reasons. Another one is ignorance. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, the Bible says, my people are destroyed. My people, I'm his people. I'm a child of God. I'm a Christian because I've accepted Christ. And I understand he's also talking to Israel. But my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, that means they had a chance of it. They refused to read it, accept it. I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. My friends, I have literally heard people tell me, I don't want to hear that, I don't want to know that, because once I know that, once I hear that, I'm responsible for that. That's right. But you're also responsible because you know that. Something else I believe. When we have Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night services, God's people are to be in God's house. God's people are also accountable for the things they're not hearing, because they could be there, and they're not there. And therefore, you're destroyed for your lack of knowledge. We have conferences here, and we have revival. We have special meetings here. And when God's people say, well, I'm too busy, I'm too tired, and they don't come, you're still responsible for what you could have had. This is the table we're to go to. So ignorance, sin, ignorance, unbelief. Romans 14:23, it says, and he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith. For whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Hebrews 3:12, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. Folks, he calls it evil. We're to have faith in Jesus Christ. Then he says, in departing from the living God. Matthew 13:58. And he did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Unbelief, lack of faith, hinders the work of God. Unbelief, lack of faith, stunts the growth of Christians. I'm going to be preaching tonight about being a winner for Jesus Christ. There's a lot of people that get weary and well-doing, and they faint before they get to the prize. A lot of people, the first sign of opposition, they quit and they turn, and they don't even want to continue on trying. That's not a winner. Unbelief stunts you from your spiritual growth. It hinders you from seeing the blessings that God wants you to have. Number four, fear. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear. Fear does not belong in God's vocabulary. But what has he given us? He's given us the spirit of power. Power is given to the child of God. We're to have faith. We're to have power. The last one I want to share is prayerlessness. I got two passages, Luke 18:1, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. I gave an illustration in our Sunday school class about praying through a problem. Many people, as we're praying, God has to lay foundations. He has to set things up for the answer of prayer. And when we begin praying for something, God is busy answering that prayer by setting things in motion, by preparing a way, depending on what the prayer may be. And as we're praying through, let's say right here is the answer to the prayer. And he's laying a block here. You keep praying. We're talking weeks, months. He's laying another block here. We're praying some more. He lays another block, and there's one more block. And what happens? Satan enters in and says, no, I don't want you to have that. I don't want you to see God's blessing. I don't want you to have God's power in your life. Once you see that miracle happen, you're going to glorify God. You're going to worship God. You're going to praise God. I'll not let it happen. So what does he do? Discouragement. By the time God's about ready to answer that prayer, Satan steps in with a swoosh of discouragement. He pounds down discouragement and all kinds of negativity and trying to stop you. He doesn't want you praying through. He doesn't want you to answer. And a lot of Christians, what they do, I guess God didn't mean for me to have it anyways. And they turn and they walk away from it. We talked about Peter walking on the water. Here he is. He actually walked on the water. Lord, if it be you, let me come out to you. Come on. He's walking. Then he sees the waves. He sees the storm. He's discouraged. And all of a sudden, he began to sink. He's going down. He reached up and grabbed his hand. Oh, ye of little faith. Oh, ye of little faith. We're to pray through. We're to trust. Prayerlessness. You ought to savor the power of God in your life and not let anything stop that. We receive God's power through witnessing and telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ. He says to the believer, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The yoke, the work of God, he came to seek and to save that which is lost. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. He says, ye shall be power, receive power. He wants you to have the power to witness. He wants you to have the power to tell the world about Jesus Christ. And you know firsthand the negativity out there. You understand what people say. But should that stop you? No. You keep going. You keep planting. You keep watering. You keep tilling the ground. You keep planting. You keep watering. You keep tilling the ground. See, we think short term. God looks long term. He understands the things that go on in people's life. He understands the years of training that's been poured into the minds of these young people. And it takes time. You plant, you water, you till. You plant, you water, you till. You keep going. And then somewhere, something's going to happen. It may be a trial in their life. It may be a trial in your life that God allows for them to see what you're going through and to see how your faith is in God and to see how you handle the affairs or the storms of life that get their attention. But ye shall receive power after the Ghost has come, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. So the power to witness. Without God's power, he tells us in John 15:5 that ye can do nothing. He says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. We have to have Jesus. We have to rely on him. We have to focus on him. We had asked an interesting question earlier. And when Jesus was talking about the disciples, they were in the ship, they were rowing. He talked about how fast their hearts were hardened. Wait a minute. Didn't they just bury John the Baptist? Didn't they just observe Jesus feed the 5,000 plus the women and children? And now they're out on the water, and they're rowing, and they're rowing, and they're rowing, but the storm has come upon them. They're afraid for their lives. They're terrified. And he said that they're afraid. Their heart was hardened. How is that? And as we discussed it, we talked about how does that affect us? These same disciples of Jesus Christ were out there administering and serving these people. They were feeding the people, as Jesus broke the bread and the fish, they would take it to him. And I was thinking, what is it like during VBS when we're feeding the kids What kind of attitudes do we see? What goes on in that lunchroom? We're out there. We got Anna here and others that help. They're making sure all the food is in the right places. They make sure everybody follows procedure. And what is the reaction of the people? I don't like that. Where's this? Where's that? I want mac and cheese. That gets discouraging. Matter of fact, remember, he's doing all the work there, and we're just the servants. And we're distributing what God has given to us. We're handing it out to these other people. And people say things. They don't listen. They don't follow procedures. And as the servant, the distributor, we sometimes get our eyes off of him and get him focused on, look what we're doing. We're serving. We're distributing. Oh, I wish he wouldn't talk. Oh, I hate that little one. You know, I want to choke him. I want to kill him. They get up and run around. They spill their milk. They do this. They do that. You get a little upset from time. Now we can understand that a little bit better. As they're out in the water and rowing and getting nowhere in the storms of life, why did they not consider Jesus? Why are they not thinking about him? Because all along, as Jesus is feeding them the bread and the fish to be distributed, they're not thinking about what he's doing. They're thinking about what they're doing. And our focus needs to be on what he's doing, because he's the one that's providing the miracles. We just get to be the hands and the feet, the tools that he uses. And therefore, hearts can easily be hardened while we're serving him. And so they didn't even consider that. Oh, my friends, we need to understand without Christ, we can do nothing. And we ought to savor the power of God in our lives. Be filled with the Holy Spirit of God and serve him. The third thing, you ought to savor God's blessing on your life. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 16 again. A blessed life is a surrendered life. He tells us in verse 24, then go to Psalm 23, verse 24, he says, then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. He's talking about full surrender. What are you going to live for in this life? Oh, I could live for myself. I can go out there and paint houses and be a contractor and do a great job. Satan won't bother me while I'm out there. Or I can serve God and do what he wants me to do. There's so many things in life that we can do. But what do you savor? He said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Deny. And take up his cross and follow me. Go to Psalms 23. Psalms 23, familiar passage. We read it a lot at funerals and gravesides, popular passage. But we want God's blessing. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. He's my leader. He's my guide. He's my provider. He leads me through life. Sometimes we just don't follow. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That word want means lack. I'll not go without if he's my shepherd. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. There's peace. There's provision right there. He restoreth my soul. When you're down, when you're discouraged, he picks you back up. He leadeth me in the paths of, I like this, righteousness. Not for your sake, but for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The shadow of death, I've been through there before. I've been down that road. When you're going down that road, you keep your eyes on him. He's the one that comforts you. You look to him and you say, Lord, I'm yours to do whatever you want. And that's easy to do if you've been serving him. If you've been surrendered to him. I remember one gentleman, pastor friend of mine in Florida, he talked about this guy in church. He hadn't been coming to church, and now he's on deathbed. He's in the hospital getting ready to die. And he says, Pastor, would you pray for me? He says, well, listen, you've been out of church. He says, Pastor, I promise, if God raises me up out of this bed, I'll be in church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. I will obey God. I will be in the house of God. Preacher says, okay, I will. And he prays for him. God raises him up. Next Sunday, Man's not there. The Sunday after that, he's not there. The Sunday after that, he's not there. 6 months later, the man's in the hospital dying again. Preacher comes in there. The man looks at the preacher and turns his head away. He knows. He knows. He's going to die because he lied before. Going through the shadow of death, if you please God and surrender to God, well, there's peace there. You can lift up your eyes, even though you're afraid, you can still lift up your eyes to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm yours. Whatever you want me to go through, I'll do it. No matter what, I will trust you. And then he says, verse 5, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. A person who's serving God will have enemies. Sometimes we try to have friends with as many people as we can. Sometimes there's people you need to separate from. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Then he says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Oh, my friend, to be in God's house, to savor the things of God, to savor the house of God, to savor the people of God, to savor the work of God, to savor the will of God. He's telling Peter, one moment, God's told you these things. I am the Messiah. At another, he says, get thee behind me, Satan. For thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And as a child of God, we need to say, what do you say? What do you desire? What do you love the most? What do you cherish? Let me ask you to bow your head.